And I want to start out by starting with a love song. Are we queued up there?
Yeah.
And now there are so many great love songs, isn't there? I mean, you can have so many. Why? I tell you, if I had to sing, or if I wanted this one song to be played to Marty, this would be my song to her. It's got a little rock to it, but the lyrics are absolutely. I'm sorry? I didn't know that. Well, let's set it off with Aerosmith. And, but this is such a great song. I don't know if you've ever really looked at the lyrics. This is my favorite.
Close my eyes, I don't wanna fall asleep, 'cause I miss you, baby.
about that, man. But wow, what a love song. So what's your definition of love? I want to read a true story that this pastor wrote. It's a true story about a young lady. And this is, I'm going to read most of my left because I'm more organized than I've ever been. I even got it typed out. So, during high school, I dated a lot of guys and I was hurt a lot. I was a very vulnerable girl because I wanted someone to live with. To love. I wanted someone to truly care about. The problem was finding the right person to love and have them appreciate and enjoy me. When I got into college, I had no intention of getting married or falling in love. I felt like I'm going to go have a good time. I'm going to experience a lot, and I'm going to get myself tied. I'm not going to get myself tied down to any person or any one thing. I am starting a clean slate. In other words, it's about good, wholesome relationships and fun and finding out what being in college is all about. I was doing well until I met Joe. I do not believe that there is such a thing as love at first sight, but at that time, I was a romantic teenager, 19, and when I saw him for the first time, I thought he was just super. He had a dynamic personality and a lot of charm. When he finally asked me out, I was beside myself. On the first date, we talked a lot and tried hard to impress each other. Boy, don't we do that? On the first date. I was a star quarterback and I never win football. On our first date, we talked a lot, tried to impress each other. A month went by before he called me and asked me for another date. I think he knew by then that I wanted to date him. He played on this, and from that time on, things were pretty heavy. I was very vulnerable because I wanted to have someone to love. Our relationship really did not start off on the right foot because we were trying to impress each other so much. I did not want him to go out with anyone else but me. I do not think at that point I neglected any of my standards or morals, but I did do things to impress him and to encourage a relationship with him. We dated and we had some pretty serious talks. We had some pretty bad fights too. He picked on me and teased me a lot. I tried to cover up hurt feelings when he would do this. I tried to laugh along with it, but it did continue to hurt. A lot of times at parties, he would just walk off and leave me. He did not give me any special attention. I felt hurt because of this. I realized at that point that there was mostly a one-sided relationship since I started working real hard to make him feel the same way that I felt towards him. This is what got me into trouble. I worked too hard at it. I started to do things that I knew he wanted, anything that could please him or would please him. This includes some heavy sexual things. I thought if I don't, he's going to go somewhere else, and I don't want to lose him. Time went on, and we ended up going to bed together and doing things that I knew were not right. But I sacrificed my morals to keep him. This is the biggest mistake a young girl can make. She thinks, if she thinks by doing what a guy wants to do, he is going to be crazy about her, but that's just simply not true. I knew Joe lost respect for me, and I lost so much respect for myself that it was awful. Because of my Christian background, I died 100 times in my own guilt. But I could not bring myself to say, "Forgive me, Lord," because I knew in the back of my mind I was going to do it again. I was trying to do anything I could do to keep him. At this point, if I could say anything to people, regardless of their age, it is this. When you get into a dating game, find a fellow you know is a Christian. One who is not ashamed to say, "I'm a Christian and I have morals too." I know that it is kind of daring to date the guys you know who are not Christians, the ones who are kind of wow. But stay away from these kinds of guys because you're going to lose something along the way.
Joe and I were having problems in our dating relationships. We fought a lot. He picked at me a lot and I got hurt a lot. I tried to explain to him the guilt I felt about sleeping with him. I tried to stop it, but he would just not accept it. I had evaluated our relationship and to put it bluntly, it stunk. He did not treat me right at all. But I thought in the back of my mind, if we get married, everything's going to be different. He's going to love me. He's going to take care of me, and he's going to take care of me for him. That was a big mistake on my part. You do not change a person no matter how much you try and no matter how much you love. You can take your dating relationship and magnify it about 10 or 20 times, and that is what your marriage relationship is. Television, books, movies, songs, all of these things that influence our lives these days make you think that you can pull everything like a rabbit out of the hat to make everything hunky-dory. But it is not like that. Marriage is tough. Even when two people really love each other and both are working at it, it is still tough. You do not change a person, no matter how much you love them. If I had magnified our relationship 10 times, or even as little as 5 times, I would have seen that in the future, Joe was going to go out on me. He was going to slip around with other girls. He was going to lose his temper. He was going to hit me. He was going to treat me like a wife, and he was not going to take the responsibility of being a husband. But I did not do this. I moved quickly. We ran off and got married. I do not blame my getting married on anyone but myself, because I knew that I should not do this. But at that moment, I made a decision about a whole lot of things. I decided if I do not do this, I'm going to lose him. What I should have decided was if he cannot wait for me and do it my way, then it is not worth it. My emotions were in complete control. My emotions were in control, and my thinking was not clear at all. I was very confused. I did not want to be hurt, but I jumped into this knowing it would be the biggest hurt in my life. When we told our parents, they were hurt and disappointed. I quit college so I could put him through college. I took any job I could get. I was a waitress. I worked at the cocktail lounge at night, which was awful. I worked as a sales clerk. I did all kinds of jobs to keep us going. Our marriage was just nothing. He did not love me. It was me loving him and trying to make him love me, trying desperately to please him, sacrificing my own feelings. But it did not work. It could not work. You could not make someone love you. They either love you or they do not. I lived in constant fear he was going to go out and find someone else, and he did exactly that. I did not want to admit it because I wanted our marriage to work. 5 months after we were married, you know what's coming? I became pregnant, and I have a beautiful little girl. That changed things for a while. He was very excited about having the baby. But a month after the baby was born, things slipped back into the way they were. And me carrying the load, trying to raise a child and support our family. We were married 3 years when things happened, which made me realize that he did not love me, that he never would love me, and he never really did love me, that he was not a good father, and that was not a response, and he was not a responsible husband. I could not handle it anymore, so we were divorced. Typical story. Would you agree?
Yeah.
Unfortunately. And the reason that I wanted to dive into this a little bit, and we're going to be going a little further with this, and again, I don't... Pastor Harry Smith, president of one of Billy Graham's institutions, wrote this. It's from his book, and it's, like I said, this is a true story. And sometimes what I want to talk about, and this is where it might get sensitive, I don't want it to be. We meet people in church. Singles meet singles in church. In fact, one of the reasons singles go to church is to what? Meet other singles. And so what happens is we start getting close to another single. And then we may find out that the relationship isn't going as well as we'd like for it to go,
and we decide not to see each other anymore. And sometimes that drives a wedge in the relationship. And some people can walk away from their faith, they can walk away from the church, they can walk away from their Bible study class, but they cannot walk away from God. And they lose that. Now, how do you make that right? How do you say, hey, how can we do this in a refreshing way, in a healthy way, in a wonderful way? And if it doesn't work out, it's okay. You cannot make someone love you. She continues, as I look back, I see where I made many mistakes. My first and foremost mistake was that I did not accept and maintain a steady relationship with God. If I had done this, I would not have found myself in the position I was in. God's love is free, and this love is like no other love you can ever experience in your life because it is whole. There is nothing lacking in the love that God can give you. Do you ever believe that you can live without love? Because you can't. But that was so good. You cannot count on the people around you to give you that love, but you can count on God. He is always there, and He never changes. Another mistake was starting off in such a hurry. This seems to be the popular thing to do these days. You think, well, I like him and he likes me. Maybe we're not. Why don't we just go ahead and see if this sex business will work out for us too if we really like it? Yeah, you end up skipping over the part where you're really good friends. Boy, isn't that true? This is what was missing in my relationship with Joe. There was no respect and no friendship. He really did not respect me and I really didn't respect him. There was no friendship there. Another mistake was getting involved sexually when I had no business doing it. I was not married. I was not old enough or mature enough to face the consequences of a sexual relationship. Just because you have all the necessary parts to have a sexual relationship with someone does not mean that you're ready to use them. It's not just a physical act, it involves your emotions. You can truly mess up your emotions by getting involved when you are not ready. Is that true? Wow. It is something that you should be held sacred for marriage. If you go back to the basics and what a relationship is all about, you will see that you have friendship first. Secondly, you are both Christians. And out of that grows your friendship even more. It is in that advanced friendship stage, listen to this, the early dating stage, that you take it slow because you learn so much about one another in that stage. You're just dating, you're getting to know one another. Sometimes that takes time. More times than not, I believe it is there that you discover you are not as compatible as you thought you were earlier. As you just continue to go out, get to know one another, the bragging stops, and you start just having a real conversation. And sometimes things will happen, but it always shows emotion. I'm going to stop right there for a second. Who's a golfer? I see one golfer. Is a golfer? Three golfers? Four golfers? Very good. Any ladies? Any ladies golf? Okay.
I go along.
You go along.
Me too.
You go along. Okay. You're the driver, you're the supporter. We hit one about 40 yards and get it off the ground. And you say, oh, that's a good shot.
I used to go to the golf cart.
You used to go to the golf cart.
I know a lot about that.
I get cured now, man.
About 20 years ago, I was invited to go golf, and I was working with a client. I'll tell you who it was. It was J.M. Pontiac in Hollywood. The vice president of the company, I did a lot of service, and I did some consulting work at the time for them. And the vice president of the company at that time asked me if I would go golfing with him, and if I would let his father-in-law ride in the golf cart with me. Now, the reason being was, he said, Larry, you got a personality. You get along with everybody. Nothing shakes you up. I mean, and he's going to be a challenge. He's his wife's dad, who's Jewish. And he's a challenge. He's a very successful businessman, and And I want the day to be a fun day for him. So I want you to ride in the golf cart with him. I said, sure. Absolutely. So the first thing we do, we get in the cart. I said, you believe in Jesus? No. So, that was an attention getter. So we're playing around. Here's a guy that's a multi-millionaire, down to earth. I loved him. We were having a great time. And we got held up, as you know, sometimes on a par three. You know, you have to wait for the, you get backed up a little bit. And while we were, his son-in-law said, Dad, why don't you tell Larry about how I was allowed to have your daughter's hand in marriage? And he says, you want me to tell that story? And he says, yeah, because it's so unique. Now, again, keep in mind, very, very successful businessman down from New York, and he's visiting, had three girls. And it's a little eccentric, but I've looked back on this conversation 100 times since, and it's been amazing. He says, when my daughters were dating, and they were all adults who were out of college now, and they had their careers, and they met, like Jimmy Sanderson, he would have them go golfing with them. Hey, want to go play some golf? You think it's nice and innocent, you want to impress your future father-in-law, and go out and play golf. How you were on that golf course told him whether or not he would accept your invitation to marry his daughter. He says, a man will show his true colors on a golf course. If he gets a bad shot and cusses, he will swear at his wife. If he throws his clubs, he'll hit his wife. Now, he didn't tell any of the boys, but that's how he believed. I can tell you, I've seen that play out more times than I would like to admit. In fact, a very good friend of mine, about five years after this, he was a builder of construction, wonderful marriage, and money was no object to him. He had lots of money. He built half of Booker Point, and so you can imagine. We were playing a round of golf, and we had a little, like a little $2 side bet. There was four of us. But it wasn't the money, but obviously it's just his pride. We're on the 18th hole. It was quite funny at the time. Of course I'm winning, so I'm having a good time.
Yeah.
So me and my partner, and here's Doug, he's over, he hits the ball two times into the water on the left. He's taking these golf clubs at about $200 a club, and he's heaving them into the water as they go. His buddy Dan comes over and grabs him and says, stop doing that. You don't want the clubs? I'll take them. That's how angry he got. About 60 days, 90 days later, Marty was still in here, I should tell you. We like to go out on we have a golf trip we used to do at the time in Tampa. We'd go for the weekend and play golf the whole weekend, have a blast. We pulled up to pick up Doug. All his clothes and everything was out in the front yard. True story. And Boca in about a $3 million home. Where's Doug? Doug wasn't there. His wife came out and had a black side of her face. Place to call. And total instant recall came to that wise man who said a man will show his true colors on a golf course. We enter in a relationship and we really don't know. We don't have an opportunity to know that. All you know is your church, a restaurant, spending a little time together. You know why? Because you have what's called a heart and you have emotions that God gave you to be attractive to one another. That's as normal as our breathing.
But sometimes we find out that the compatibility isn't there. But there are many wrong concepts about love, she went to say. This is the last thing she says. Many people confuse infatuation with real love. Others think that love at first sight is the real thing. Still others do not know the difference between lust and love. What is infatuation and how does it affect you? What is the difference between lust and love? What is sexual attraction? What is real love? Well, I think we ought to dive into that a little bit and see if we can figure it out. What is infatuation? What would be your definition of infatuation?
Attraction to another, physical attraction.
Flirting.
That starts.
And there's also a personality connection there. You have you have some things in common. You just, but you have a good vibe.
Marty's out of the room. I can honestly tell you, she was infatuated.
We know we can see that.
It still is. An infatuation is a state of being completely carried away by an attraction to someone else. The dictionary calls it being blindly in love. We're all familiar with that, right? In other words, you are so carried away by this that you don't know what you're doing. That's infatuation. The one involved in a romantic infatuation usually cannot think of anything or anyone else other than that person he or she is in love with. And infatuation is an exciting experience, an emotional high, but it never lasts long. This I didn't know. I've got this again through this pastor he was talking about in so many places where he got his statistics. It doesn't last long because why? It's not love. It's not true love. It's just an infatuation. I think we called it when I was a kid, puppy love.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, sometimes you just had this infatuation. You were so taken with her and said, well, why don't you ask her? I can't. All of a sudden you just see her come. You start sweating. you're not the same. Everything starts to go a little nuts. And one of the signs of infatuation, we're going to test on this later, one of the signs of infatuation is that you tend to idolize that person you think you are in love with. You idolize. Everything they say or do seems to be just perfect. You don't see any flaws. Now here's the base. This is the best part. We can all say, I think we've been there, done that, got the T-shirt. Other people can see plenty of danger signals. It's a joke. I know her, but you know what I mean. Be careful. Be careful. You can't see it because you're infatuated. You're blinded. How many have been there? We've done that. And yet, when we're there, when our emotions are there, and we think we got it, we don't.
Some guys are real charmers.
They go to the other part. No, but you're right. They are. So many men, a lot of times guys are like this. And I know vanity runs across both genders. But some guys don't come on, ladies.
Like sweep you off your feet.
They give you that thing. He just thinks he's a props gift.
Sweep you off your feet.
If he asked me out, I'd go. Yeah,
that's true.
Then guys are saying, "Well, she asked her. Oh, she's too into herself. Every little part of her face has got to be perfect before she walks out the front door." But if she asked me out, if I had the nerve, our romantic feelings take over and you are not using ordinary good sense or judgment. There she is.
Perfect timing.
Now I gotta start being honest again. Okay, when you're involved in a romantic infatuation, you tend to be disorganized.
You are not yourself. You are irresponsible and you tend to neglect your duties. Sometimes young people, particularly the young people, will daydream and laze around, not doing their duties. Someone will ask, what's the matter with you, Carolyn? You're not yourself. Carolyn will smile back and sweetly say, oh, I'm in love. No, she's not. She's infatuated. And it's hard to get them out of that stage, by the way. But the upside is, thankfully, like the pastor said, it doesn't last long. It's just during that stage, she's a danger to herself, or he is. And we got to watch it. Next thing you know, they might be back from Vegas. We're here. Okay, if she were in love and her love was the real thing, she would be concerned about her duties, preparing and planning for her future. Most infatuations, like I said earlier, do not last long. What does last is the bitter fruit of wrongdoing committed during that infatuation period. Remember, when you're infatuated, you don't use common sense. Your romantic feelings are in control. When this happens, you cannot do some things that you will, when this happens, you be careful to not do certain things that you will regret for the rest of your life. Pretty accurate. Pretty true stuff. So let me ask you this, what's lust? What is lust?
It's sexually based.
It's just
desire. It is. It's just desire. Yeah. Sexual
attraction, yes.
Yeah. It's a feeling.
Well, lust. No, you can be attracted to somebody, but I think lust is thinking about it, pondering the sexual
image
in your head over and over and over and over and over again. And that's my interpretation.
I think you're safe. Yeah.
Something about the person, whether it's mentally, physically, spiritually, or financially, that overbearingly attracts people.
Okay. What?
Intense or unbridled sexual desire.
Hold up.
Pardon me? Does not have to be sexual.
Doesn't have to be, but the most of the time it is.
Lust is when you want to crawl all over the girl you're with.
Yeah.
It could be a craving.
I crave her. Alright, here's what it says. Lust is an intense desire. An intense desire, not just a desire. Oh, I'm sorry, Moses.
It's eye-centered.
It's what?
Eye-centered.
Very much so. We're going to talk about that. Very much so. That's called selfish lust.
Yes.
That's next. Lust is an intense desire to satisfy one's sexual appetite. And I know a lot of you were saying that. You were giving the Christian answer. But seriously, lust is wanting to satisfy one's sexual appetite. Lust often goes under the name of love, but lust and love, make no mistake, are two different things.
Now, not to go too further, but I've heard many pastors before talk about when dealing with lust.
Yeah.
And marriage, you should lust after your wife.
Yeah.
So it could be used in a good way.
Could be used in a good way. That's exactly right. But if you lusted after her, I think prior, you probably won't get married.
Right. Absolutely.
If you follow the steps. Right? Okay. What is selfish love? Which Moses already answered, actually. The emphasis on getting something is on getting something. Lust demands immediate satisfaction. Lust says, I want it for my own pleasure. It's about me.
Narcissistic.
I could care less about you. I want to get sexually satisfied, and it's a selfish lust,
We are not taping this particular lesson. We are.
Clicker, you're going to sell the copy.
I'm from South Carolina. I'm here impressing Larry Pettit. I'm doing a terrific impersonation. Love is willing. What is selfish love? Love is willing to wait. We don't care about love right now. Real love will wait, however, for the right time and the right circumstances. Now, let's get into our Bible. The Bible gives us examples on both lust and love. And I want to give you one on lust. Let's turn to 2 Samuel. You're all familiar with this. Chapter 13. Oh, I forgot to start with my Bible. I've got my Bible. Well, I'm not going to forget. You're up next week, so you can't forget that. I'll give you the word. Look through it.
Next week?
Yeah.
Write it down.
Okay. 2 Samuel 13. And we're going to read 1 through 19. And what we're talking about is Ammon, one of David's sons, thought that he was madly in love with Tamar, his half-sister. Remember this story?
Yes.
He desired her so much that he made himself sick, but it's got an unfortunate ending. So are we all there, 2 Samuel? We're ready to go? Okay, Medora.
In the course of time, Amnon, son of David, fell in love with Tamar, the beautiful sister of Absalom, son of David. Amnon became frustrated to the point of illness on account of his sister Tamar, for she was a virgin and it seemed impossible for him to do anything to her. Now Amnon had a friend named Jonadab, son of Shimeah, David's brother. Jonadab was a very shrewd man. He asked Amnon, "Why do you, the king's son, look so haggard morning after morning? Won't you tell me?" Amnon said to him, "I'm in love with Tamar, my brother Absalom's sister." "Go to bed and pretend to be ill," Jonadab said. "When your father comes to see you, say to him, 'I would like my sister Tamar to come and give me something to eat. Let her prepare the food in my sight so I may watch her and then eat it from her hand.'" So Amnon lay down and pretended to be ill. When the king came to see him, Amnon said to him, "I would like my sister Tamar to come and make some special bread in my sight, so I may eat from her hand." David sent word to Tamar at the palace, "Go to the house of your brother Amnon and prepare some food for him." So Tamar went to the house of her brother Amnon, who was lying down. She took some dough, kneaded it, made the bread in his sight, and baked it. Then she took the pan and served him the bread, but he refused to eat. "Send everyone out of here," Amnon said, so everyone left him. Then Amnon said to Tamar, "Bring the food here into my bedroom so I may eat from your hand." And Tamar took the bread she had prepared and brought it to her brother Amnon in his bedroom. But when she took it to him to eat, he grabbed her and said, "Come to bed with me, my sister." "Don't, my brother," she said to him, "don't force me. Such a thing should not be done in Israel. Don't do this wicked thing. What about me? Where could I get rid of my disgrace? And what about you? You would be like one of the wicked fools in Israel. Please speak to the king. He will not keep me from being married to you." But he refused to listen to her, and since he was stronger than she, he raped her. Then Amnon hated her with intense hatred. In fact, he hated her more than he had loved her. Amnon said to her, "Get up and get out." "No," she said to him, "sending me away would be a greater wrong than what you have already done to me." But he refused to listen to her. He called his personal servant and said, "Get this woman out of here," and bolted the door after her. So his servant put her out and bolted the door after her. She was wearing a richly ornamented robe, for this was the kind of garment the virgin daughters of the king wore. Tamar put ashes on her head and tore the ornamented robe she was wearing. She put her hand on her head and went away, weeping aloud as she went.
Lust, it ended up in rape. True story, by the way. This isn't, I wonder if this would happen. Right? We're reading God's word. God wanted you to understand what's going on here. This story could easily have been kept out. It's a little embarrassing. But at the same time, what's the application? The application is we have to learn what real love is. We have to learn that. And so here's a situation that the boat ends up destroying their lives. But one most important thing, what happened? As soon as it was over, the act was over, he had no, his love
was not disgusting.
Don't misunderstand, lust is not love. He thought he was in love with her. He really just lusted after her. And when he finally set it up, he raped her. And when that was done, he was done with her. Kicked her out of the room. Let's look at the other side of the coin. Let's turn to Genesis 29. We're going to read another familiar story. It's one of the best love stories, I think, that is amazing. This has to do with Jacob and Rachel. Mm-hmm. What's going on? You know the story, but it's amazing. The love. This is love. You got it? Okay. We're going to read Genesis 29, 18 through 30. 12 verses, 18 through 30. Everybody ready?
Yeah.
All right, let's go.
Jacob was in love with Rachel and said, "I'll work for you 7 years in return for your younger daughter, Rachel." Laban said, "It's better that I give her to you than to some other man. Stay here with me." So Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel. They seemed like only a few days to him because of his love for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife. My time is completed, and I want to make love to her." So Laban brought together all the people of the place and gave a feast. But when evening came, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob. And Jacob made love to her. Laban gave his servant Zilpah to his daughter as her attendant. When morning came, there was Leah. So Jacob said to Laban, "What is this you have done to me? I served you for Rachel, didn't I? Why have you deceived me?" Laban replied, "It is not our custom here to give the younger daughter in marriage before the older one. Finish this daughter's bridal week. Then we will give you the younger one also in return for another 7 years of work." And Jacob did so. He finished the week with Leah, and then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel to be his wife.
That's love. He was tricked. He says, "You go to work for me for 7 years, and I'll give you my daughter that you want to marry." And he did. And I think the Bible says 7 years went fast, real fast. He said, "It's love for her." And that's romantic. That's love. Only to find out he was hoodwinked, but he was willing to wait and work another 7 years. He invested 14 years for his future. And he did it without complaint. Maybe he put up a little question. But other than that, he says, "Hey, it's not our custom to end for another son."
That's the line. Did he have Rachel live to Leah, or did he have to walk 7 years and end
Rachel? I think it says that he had Rachel. After he says, "Finish out the bride week, then I'll give you Rachel, but you got to work another 7 years." And he did. That's love. That's what I'm talking about. That's what I would not have done. No, I would. I would.
It's not like that anymore.
It's not like that anymore. It's rare. It's rare. Probably somewhere in the northern Tibet. It is rare. It's rare. So what is sexual attraction? Sexual attraction is a physical attraction between a guy and a girl. We are built with a sex drive which causes us to be interested in the opposite sex. There's nothing wrong or sinful about that. God made us this way. Sin comes when we attempt to satisfy our sexual drive the wrong way. So if I look at you and go, "That little, you know, I'm feeling that inside. I'm still good. I'm still good. I haven't crossed over the sin line." Right? right? I'm just having fun with all my desires that God put in us. There's nothing wrong with
that. That's the lust of the eyes.
Yeah. To be sexually attracted to someone does not mean that you're in love with that person. Remember the time? A fellow sees a girl with a beautiful figure and he says, wow! A girl sees a handsome football player and her heart skips a beat or two. Is that love?
No.
That's a physical attraction. No, simply that. Okay, movies, television, magazines, and books constantly bombard us with the idea that find someone who turns you on. If you have good sex life, that's all that matters. Who's the author of this one? Right?
Hugh Hefner.
Yeah.
How many wives has he had so far?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Remember, sexual attraction is not love. I'll finish up here a little bit. There's a vital place in marriage for sexual attraction, but marriage cannot be built on sexual attraction alone. Lust. There are couples by the thousands who could not or did not resist sexual involvement before they were married, but now they cannot stand to touch each other. There's couples like that, thousands. What is real love? Now let's get down to it. What is real love?
I think real love is based on
commitment and not what he wants.
An action.
It's an action.
Yeah.
Action, right?
Decision, too.
Decision.
Choice.
It's all good. Moses.
Other-centered.
Self-centered, but other-centered. That's very good. Real love has many qualities. We can go back to the Corinthians, too, but it does not contain the magical element of physical attraction, but it is a lot more than this. Love has roots in friendship. In true love, you love the total person. You enjoy being with that person, sharing things with them. Real love is unselfish. It sacrifices for the one it loves, and it carries with it the vital quality of commitment. Everything you guys are saying.
Unconditional,
just like Christ loves us. It doesn't give up or quit when problems come along. Real love will bring out the best in you. I agree. It'll bring out the best in you. Real love you want the one you love to be proud of. If you're just infatuated with one of you're just infatuated with another mistake. All right, where did I go? Where was it? Message. If you're just infatuated with someone, you may laze around and daydream. But if your love is real, you apply yourself to your work, you make plans, and you prepare for the future. Real love is not just a wonderful feeling that strikes you suddenly. It takes time to grow and develop. Some of the most popular songs in the world of music give the wrong impression that falling in love with someone at first sight is real love. This is great. You don't teach this to your kids. You don't fall into real love. You grow into it. You have to know a person before you can love that person with real love. It is impossible to truly know someone at first sight, and it is likewise impossible to have a real love for someone at first sight. You're confusing that with attraction. Precious love is another step. We long, we got real love, now we have precious love. Satan does not want you to know and or experience true love. First of all, know that. This is our scripture. Satan doesn't want you to have it. That is why he promotes all kinds of false love. He wants you to get involved in sex outside of your marriage. He wants to generally just mess your life up so that you can think it's not a life that's not worth living. He would rather have you spend more time with the guys than with your family. He'll have you spending more time at work than what's really necessary, but you'll feel guilty and you need to get the work done, so you sacrifice your family. And it just goes on and on, how he'll try to draw that wedge, and then the next thing you know, and the guy comes home from work. Say, where have you been? You know, Din-Din is at 6 o'clock. And he feels funny, or he feels bad, or he makes the thing forget it, another one out. But seriously, it's causing a rift of some kind. Boy, say, yeah, that's it. You don't have to take that, Chris, and don't put up with it. You either, Ross, you were part of that, you deserve some understanding. Like she did. Precious love. We'll read this real quickly. God, on the other hand, loves you supremely and desires only the best for you. He wants you to have precious love, not cheap sex. If it is his will for you to be married, you will be married. He has just the right person for you. He wants you to have a mate who loves you unselfishly and is committed to you for life. And he likewise wants you to be committed to that person for life. He wants your home to be a little bit of heaven on earth. In May of 1973, in the little town of West Point, Mississippi, a beautiful marriage of 25 years ended in the most dramatic way. The devoted wife of a local newspaper editor walked out of the evening church service. She smiled happily and spoke to her friends, and then fell dead on the church lawn. Emergency efforts to revive her were to no avail. To her friends and husband, it seemed as though she walked out of church straight into heaven. This little city was stunned. Letters and telegrams poured to the bereaved husband, for she was warmly loved and admired. One day after the funeral, her husband, Henry Harris, wrote a long, heartfelt tribute to his wife. Here in part is what Mr. Harris wrote to his lovely wife. She walked right out of church and right into heaven. As one friend expressed it, she came to West Point to go to church, and she left from the church. He was remembering the spring of 1946 when she graduated from the Mississippi State College for Women and came to West Point to be an assistant to the pastor of First Baptist Church. Actually, she looked to work in West Point as temporary because she was convinced the Lord was calling her to become a foreign missionary. But the Lord was giving me a different message. I knew she was the girl. And later that year, one night of December 10th, 1946, I nervously asked her to become Mrs. Henry Harris. Her answer was not really a no, rather it was silence. And the silence went on for days and weeks. She loved me. She timidly told me so. But she felt very strongly that the Lord wanted her on the same mission field. On some mission field. And I used her every power of persuasion to convince her that Henry Harris was her lifetime mission field. It took months of wooing. Much more than that, it was a strange and wonderful and marvelous courtship which involved much more than the whispering of sweet nothings. While I wanted her to be my wife more than anything in the world, I too wanted God's will to be done. And for weeks and months, our dates were lengthy sessions of prayer. 1 year to the day after that proposal, we became man and wife. There's absolutely no doubt that God's will was done. There was never a happier marriage. Some say modern couples will find this hard to believe, but for 25 years, 5 months, and 10 days, we never had an argument. Surely there must have been some times of disagreements, but now, in looking back across those wonderful years, I can't recall a single one of the consequences. I know that the coming weeks and months will be extremely hard. There will be times when I will find a quiet place and let the tears flow. Nothing's wrong with that. But heaven is dear because Wanda is waiting there. And I still have her and 4 wonderful children. Every year I added another long-stemmed red rose to those sent to her on December the 10th. There were 25 in the last bouquet. Then on Tuesday, I told the florist to just cover the coffin with red roses and put a big urn on each end filled with red roses. You see, they have to last a long time till we are together again. I don't believe a day has passed in 25 years that I didn't tell her I loved her. And yet, I don't believe she ever knew how much she meant to me and how much I truly loved her. And while I kept telling her my love every day, I kept thanking God for letting her share this portion of my life. As I've said before, in trying feebly to pay tribute to a departed friend, but never with a more, but never with a more meaning than now, thank God for the memories. This is precious love. What young couple would not want such a marriage as this? Such a marriage can be yours if you seek God's will. Find it, trust it, and follow it. Amen.
Amen.
So real quickly, I got my eight questions for you. Not even that. True or false? The I don't want to lose him attitude can lead to very big
trouble.
True. That's true. It is a tragic mistake for a girl to sacrifice her morals to keep a boyfriend.
True.
It is all right for a Christian to date non-Christians.
False.
This is a tricky one, isn't it? True or false? What I got?
False.
True or
false? False.
It's false. That's right.
False.
It's false. Doesn't say you never should. It just says right for a Christian to date non-Christians. It's not. But you might find that exception. But see, here's the problem when you do that. You're tinkering. You're not listening to your father who says, wait a minute. You can go to those houses you call bars. I got one that I call love.